Hello, my name is Anne Weyenberg, professor and president of the Institute for European Studies of the Université Libre de Bruxelles. I'm also coordinator of ECLAN, the European Criminal Law Academic Network. This speech concerns the role of the Court of Justice of the European Union in criminal matters under the Lisbon Treaty. The competence of the Court in police and judicial cooperation in criminal matters has considerably evolved since this field was included in EU law by the Treaty of Maastricht. This speech will be divided in two parts. I will first address the evolution of the Court of Justice jurisdiction. I will then say a few words about the case law of the Court in the field. In the evolution of the Court of Justice competence, three main stages must be distinguished. The first stage corresponds to the third pillar of the Maastricht Treaty, when the Court of Justice jurisdiction in criminal matters was almost totally excluded. The second stage corresponds to the third pillar of the Treaties of Amsterdam and Nice, when the Court had a restricted competence in criminal matters if compared to its competence in first pillar matters, that is, in EC law. Thus, some types of action were not available in criminal matters. There was no action for compensation, no action for failure to act, and most importantly, no infringement procedure. Indeed, unlike in EC law, there was no possibility to sanction financially a member state which failed to comply with its EU obligations, for instance, a member state that did not transpose a framework decision, for instance, the 2002 framework decision on the European Arrest Warrant, or a member state which transposed it incorrectly. The Court of Justice had jurisdiction to give preliminary rulings. This competence was again limited in comparison with the normal EC preliminary ruling competence of the Court. It was especially subject to an individual declaration of acceptance by each member state. Finally, actions for annulment could be brought before the Court, but these were also subject to important restrictions concerning both the type of act that could be targeted and who could bring an action. As we will see in the second part of this speech, these restrictions did not prevent the Court from giving judgments that have been essential for the EU area for criminal justice. Think, for instance, of the preliminary rulings relating to the framework decision on the European Arrest Warrant, those relating to the 2001 framework decision on the standing of victims in criminal proceedings, or those relating to the ne bis in idem principle. It is during this second stage that an urgent preliminary ruling procedure, the so-called PPU, was established, which is applicable since March 2008 to all fields covered by the area of freedom, security and justice, including cooperation in criminal matters. Such urgent procedure is applicable either at the request of the referring national court or tribunal, or exceptionally on the court's on motion. The effects of this procedure are important because instead of waiting around 1 year and a half for the court's ruling, the referring national court receives an answer within a few months. For example, in the West case, the reference for a preliminary ruling was made in April 2012 and The judgment was given in June 2012. The third stage in the Court of Justice competence evolution began with the entry into force of the Lisbon Treaty, the 1st December 2009. As you know, the Lisbon Treaty communitarized the field of police and judicial cooperation in criminal matters. This logically resulted in the full jurisdiction of the court. Therefore, three new actions have become available in criminal matters: the action for compensation, the action for failure to act, and the infringement procedure. As a consequence, member states which do not comply with their EU obligations, for instance, by not transposing or transposing incorrectly the directives in the field, can be imposed a financial penalty. Regarding the action for annulment, it must be noted that since the entry into force of the Lisbon Treaty, all legislative acts and acts of EU institutions and bodies intended to produce legal effects vis-à-vis third parties can be brought before the court. Moreover, the number of plaintiffs that can bring an action for annulment has also been broadened. Finally, since Lisbon, the court has full jurisdiction to give preliminary rulings independently of any declaration of acceptance by the member state. Any national court or tribunal that considers it necessary may request the court to give a ruling on the interpretation of validity of EU law. The courts and tribunals against whose decisions there is no judicial remedy must bring the matter before the court. However, one general exception to the jurisdiction of the court still remains. It is provided for in Article 276 of the TFEU, according to which the court has no jurisdiction to review the validity or proportionality of operations carried out by the police or other law enforcement services of a member state, or the exercise of the responsibilities incumbent upon member states with regard to the maintenance of law and order and the safeguarding of internal security. The new competence of the court, namely the full Court of Justice competence with the exception I just mentioned, was immediately applicable to all new acts adopted after 1st December 2009. Its application to old acts adopted before the entry into force of the Lisbon Treaty was, however, postponed until the 1st December 2014. This transitional regime was set out in Protocol number 36 on transitional provisions of the Lisbon Treaty. This means that since 1st December 2014, the new Court of Justice competence applies to all acts of police and judicial cooperation in criminal matters, including the ones adopted before 1st December 2009, before 1st December the framework decision of 2002 on the European arrest warrant, for instance. This is, of course, an essential change. Indeed, many of the old instruments have not been transposed or were not transposed correctly. This is crystal clear if you take a look at the Commission's evaluation report on the instruments implementing the principle of mutual recognition. The full competence of the court should give these texts a second life, since the European Commission may launch infringement proceedings against recalcitrant member states. The list of old acts is long. It contains around 120 texts. So the Commission will, of course, not be able to launch proceedings relating to all these acts. It will surely make a selection and choose the most important ones. I will now move to the second part of this speech relating to the case law of the court. With few exceptions, most rulings of the court concern old instruments, namely instruments adopted before the entry into force of the Lisbon Treaty. As I said earlier, and in spite of the restrictions to the Court of Justice competence, essential rulings to the EU area of criminal justice were given. Time constraints will not allow me to be exhaustive, but I would like to provide some examples. It is possible to classify the Courts of Justice decisions in four different groups. Decisions relating to the validity and the legality of EU instruments. Decisions interpreting instruments of approximation of criminal procedure. Decisions relating to mutual recognition, mainly the European Arrest Warrant. And finally, decisions relating to the ne bis in idem principle. Let us begin with the first group of decisions relating to the validity or legality of EU instruments. They follow either actions for annulment or preliminary questions of validity of EU law. Before Lisbon, actions for annulment were brought against some instruments approximating substantive criminal law, leading to the annulment of the framework decision on the protection of the environment through criminal law and of the framework decision on ship source pollution. These were annulled for reasons linked to their legal basis. They had been adopted under the third pillar of the treaty when they should have been adopted under the first pillar. Since the Treaty of Lisbon abolished the third pillar and communitarized cooperation in criminal matters, it put an end to the conflicts of legal bases between the first and the third pillar. However, conflicts of legal bases remain, as is shown by the ruling of the court in the case Commission versus Parliament and Council of 6 May 2014, where the court annulled the directive of 2011 facilitating the cross-border exchange of information on road safety-related traffic offences. According to the court, this instrument, adopted after the entry into force of the Lisbon Treaty, should have been adopted on the basis of Article 91 relating to transport policy, not Article 87 on police cooperation. Another decision should be mentioned, namely the preliminary ruling of the court of 8 April 2014 in the Digital Rights Ireland case. In this case, the court declared the directive of 15 March 2006 on data retention invalid. This data retention directive was a much debated instrument. It was enacted in the context of the fight against terrorism. It was considered necessary for the competent law enforcement authorities to have data concerning who communicated with whom, at what time and through which means. Providers of publicly available electronic communication services or of public communications network were thus obliged to keep such data between 6 months and 2 years. the court mainly based its invalidity decision on the fact that the directive seriously and disproportionately interfered with fundamental rights, namely the respect for private life and the protection of personal data. The court's ruling has, of course, very important consequences, in the details of which I will not enter here. The second group of the Court of Justice decisions are those interpreting instruments of approximation of criminal procedure, mainly the 2001 framework decision on the standing of victims in criminal proceedings. Through its rulings, the court made useful precisions on how to interpret some provisions of this text. But as you know, this text was recently replaced by a new directive, the directive of October 2012, establishing minimum standards on the rights, support and protection of victims of crime. The third group of decisions are those relating to the instruments implementing the mutual recognition principle, mainly the framework decision of 2002 on the European Arrest Warrant. Many decisions have been issued. Some of them concern the extent of the control that may be performed by the executing authority and are linked to the protection of human rights. And in this regard, I would like to refer to four cases: the Mantello decision of 2010, the Radu decision of 2013, the Meloni decision of February 2013, and the Jeremy F. case of May 2013. These rulings are quite interesting. The court is clearly uncomfortable. These decisions show very clearly the main difficulty of the EU criminal area, namely finding the right balance between the efficiency of mutual recognition and mutual trust, on the one hand, and the control of the protection of human rights, on the other. In Mantello and Radu, the court rephrased the questions put before it with a view to restricting its answer and avoiding difficulties. These are rather brief and disappointing decisions which focus on the efficiency of mutual recognition and tend to limit the scope of control of the executing member states. A clear evolution can be witnessed in the Jeremy F. case, where the court clearly seeks a compromise between efficiency and protection of human rights. Last but not least, the last group of decisions concern the nebis in idem principle, enshrined in Article 54 of the Schengen Convention and in Article 50 of the Charter of Fundamental Rights. Most judgments of the court interpret Article 54 of the Schengen Convention, but some interpret Article 50 of the Charter. Here, I refer mainly to the decision of February 2013 in Aglakaren versus Hans Ackerberg Fransson. Most of the time, the court gave a broad interpretation of the nebis in idem principle and of its constituent elements, the notion of bis and the notion of idem. This case law is thus favorable to the individuals. I refer here, for instance, to the 2003 Gozutok and Brugge decision, to the 2006 Van Esbroek decision, to the Van Straten and Gasparini cases, but also to a more recent decision, the so-called M case of 5 June 2014. The Spasik decision of 27 May 2014 should also be mentioned, since it concerns the articulation between Article 54 of the Schengen Convention and Article 50 of the Charter of Human Rights. It partly answers the question of whether the limits of Article 54 of the Schengen Convention are compatible with Article 50 of the Charter. And the Court considers that, yes, the limits in Article 54 of the Schengen Convention are compatible with Article 50 of the Charter. I come to my conclusion. The examples I just gave show to what extent the Court of Justice contribution is essential to the EU area of criminal justice. With the entry into force of the Lisbon Treaty, and now with the end of the transitional period on 1st December 2014, a new era has opened for the courts in the field of police and judicial cooperation in criminal matters. I would like to finish with these words. More than ever, the future of the EU area of criminal justice lies in the hands of the court. However, to play its role to the fullest extent, the Court of Justice depends on the opportunities it is given by national courts and tribunals to exercise its competence. So, the dialogue of national judges and the court remains essential and should, of course, be encouraged. Thank you very much.